Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Jellyfish and Salesforce's webinar on hyper-personalisation. As one of Salesforce's premium partners, we're always excited to collaborate with the Salesforce team, whether it be working on joint clients or pitching for new business or running events like today. We see the future of our collaboration with Salesforce as one of the biggest parts of our business moving forward. For many of our clients, Salesforce's technology is crucial to the day-to-day success of their businesses, though this is obviously underpinned by great marketeers like yourselves. This brings me to a really nice stat that I saw the other day. And basically, in today's market, it's no longer about trying to convince people to buy from you or work with your company. It's about delivering fantastic customer experience that keeps people coming back. And this is backed by this nice stat. So 80% of people are more likely to do business with a brand that offers a personalized experience. Before I hand over to the speakers, there is a little bit of housekeeping. So if anyone has any questions during the talks, please can you enter these into the Q&A section. I will, of course, ask these at the end of the talks. And with this, let me hand over to the experts on the call. So we have Mike and Bradley from Jellyfish and Poppy from Salesforce, who will be kicking us off with an introduction to Salesforce Marketing Cloud. Over to you, Poppy.
Solly, hello, everyone. So as mentioned, my name is Poppy Dodge. I'm part of the Salesforce Marketing Cloud team. And what I'm going to do is take you through a brief overview of what Salesforce marketing is, why it's important in the context today. And then a little bit later on, I'll be going into the platform itself to show you what it looks like. So before we get started, just to cover off and make sure the legal team are nice and happy, this is just a quick reminder that you're seeing here, as you would with any Salesforce presentation that we have, just to remind that any purchasing decisions on products and services should be made on those that are currently available. But we're pretty clear today because everything we're talking about is already there. All right. So moving on then into the next piece, just to get us started here, what I wanted to show was just a view of the types of companies that we're working with. We work with many different brands of various sizes within various industries across the globe. And this is just to give you an idea of some of those. And really the key message that I wanted you to get from this particular view is that there are many different people on the call today, as there always are with these webinars that we join. And so whether you're within a company that serves B2B or you're direct to consumer, whether you're large or small, if you're starting off in your transformation digitally, or if you're actually quite far into it, regardless of any of those variations, Salesforce Marketing Cloud is helping customers similar to yourselves, businesses similar to yourselves across the globe to be successful in their digital marketing efforts. So be assured there. And it's helping them do so by overcoming their digital marketing challenges. And really, these challenges all roll up under the same umbrella of providing a truly personalized customer experience. And we know as businesses that we need to deliver these personalized experiences. We've heard already just now that customers are more likely to do business if the experience they receive from a brand is more personalized. But not only do customers want this, they actually also expect this. And 57% even will switch to a competitor if they don't receive this. So it's not about the product or the service being better at wherever they switch to, it's about the experience being better. And that's true of both B2B and B2C worlds. So we know as businesses that we need to deliver this. And many companies have been striving towards this for a long time now, especially within the digital part of the customer experience. But it's important to bring this into the context of today, I think, because digitally now is really the only way amidst this COVID-19 time that we can experience brands that we want to. And so for brands that have been relying on face-to-face interactions to deliver their messaging, to deliver the theme and the vibe that they want to give customers with their brands, we can no longer do this and we need to switch everything digitally. So it's incredibly important to be focusing on this just now and make sure that as we're talking to our customers, we are still getting across everything that we need to. So how can Salesforce Marketing Cloud help you to deliver on this experience? Well, through the four pieces that we see here on this particular view. So Salesforce Marketing Cloud is helping brands to elevate their customer relationships with one-to-one engagements at scale, with for some customers at huge scale. by these four pieces. So the first one is really knowing the customer, knowing who they are, bringing all the data into the platform that you would need to across any sources that you may have, and understanding who that individual is. And the second piece down, really using that data to deliver very personalized and real-time experiences where necessary. And this can be powered by artificial intelligence and areas that we would want that to help us with. And then the third piece down there, engaging throughout the entire customer journey, not just through those channels within marketing, but also throughout the rest of the customer lifecycle with all the different parts of our business that a customer might touch as they're going through that journey with us. So sales, service, etc. And then finally, coming to the bottom here, analyzing the impact of those efforts, making sure that we're maximizing ROI and driving business growth where we can, even in these times. There's still growth that we can be driving. So now we've had a very brief overview of Marketing Cloud. We're going to hear from Mike now as to how Jellyfish is using Marketing Cloud to benefit one of their clients going forward, which is Toyota. Over to you, Mike.
Great. Hi, guys. So yeah, I'm Mike Hall. I'm the email marketing automation director at Jellyfish. I manage a team of email marketing specialists and now Salesforce Marketing Cloud consultants. And we support a number of clients globally in their email marketing strategy and now in their Salesforce Marketing Cloud world as well. So when we were thinking of a case study to present on today's webinar, we were looking for an example of a brand that we think does personalization well. And the work we do with Toyota was really the first thing that came to mind. So we've been a digital partner to Toyota for the last 4 years, and we focus on the after sales side of the business. So everything from once you've owned, once you've purchased a Toyota, it's making sure that Toyota is really top of mind for everything you might need after that. So coming back to the service center to make sure your MOTs are done there, your services are done there, you're getting your wiper blades changed there, or even getting a new set of tires, and really making sure, yeah, Toyota's always front of mind, and you're not you're not going to a competitor such as Halfords or QuickFit in the UK. So our customer in all this are the 190 different franchised Toyota centers up and down the country, and they really understand that having to manage these customer communications that we're sending whilst retaining brand consistency and having accurate data, having database management skills and understanding these the complexities of email marketing and being able to follow a rigorous QA and testing process really would be a tall ask, even if these centers had dedicated marketing teams, which of course most of them do not. So really, these centers are great at selling cars and servicing cars, and they leave the marketing communications to us so they can focus on really doing what they do best. So the way we get around this is that we actually centrally manage these communications, these important communications, on behalf of these 190 different service centers. But with that centrally managed communication strategy comes its own challenge, in that you do run the risk of losing that personal touch that people may come to expect. So people are very passionate and protective over their cars, and they like to feel that they're dealing with someone that really knows them and knows their vehicle, and they like that personal touch. They don't want to feel like they're just a big number in a centrally managed database. So yeah, really we're competing with independent local family run garages, but also those big players I mentioned earlier like Halfords and QuickFit. So to kind of just recap the challenge here, it's our challenge for our customer is to send these communications to in an efficient way that feel local, personalized, and that the centers really know you and your vehicle, whilst making sure they're consistently on brand and contain accurate and up-to-date data. As if that wasn't quite a challenge enough, we see in the automotive sector here that last year it had actually the lowest open rates in email from any other industry, at just 12.6%. So really, we have to think outside the box here and look for new ways of doing things in order to stand out. The way that we've been able to meet this challenge has really been down to one thing, and the name of the event may have given this away, but it's been down to really personalization. And just one thing I would say here is that whilst today we are very much focusing on the email channel, hopefully many of the principles we're talking about here will apply to any of the channels that you're using to communicate with your customers. We know that personalization is high up on the agenda. The stat that Ollie gave us at the beginning, and Poppy as well, kind of demonstrates this. And just to back it up even further, we've got some more stats here as well. But And the fact I think we've had such interest in today's webinar as well also displays that it's likely high up on your agendas too. So we're seeing more and more companies across many different industries realize that in order to stand out and deliver those exceptional digital experiences, that personalization really is key. But consumers are expecting more. And now we see that personalization is quickly being overtaken by hyper-personalization, and that great brands are really setting their sights on delivering these hyper-personalized experiences. So what do we mean by this? Well, personalization, especially in email, is nothing new. We've seen hello first name in email campaigns for years. And if you look through your inbox today, I'm sure you'll find a ton. And it's great. You know, this really works and people love to see their own name. But personalization we're talking about today is really so much more than this. And when it's done right, you shouldn't even necessarily know it's happening. So hyper-personalization really is about the content you're serving up, the imagery or the tone of voice, or even the time in which you're sending the campaign, tailored down to that individual level. So it's about really going above and beyond just bundling people into segments and starting to deliver these campaigns to a segment of just one person. So we're going to take a look now at some of the ways we've done this with Toyota and the ways that we're personalizing these campaigns beyond just hi first name. The very first thing is we're starting with a sender name here. So the moment this campaign hits your inbox, it's from your local Toyota service center. It doesn't appear from Toyota GB or some like centrally managed database. It really is the service center that we know you interact with. We know that you last took your vehicle to, and you can see some of the examples here. So we're already starting to build that trust before the campaign has even been opened. And this also has a bigger impact on open rates, which we'll come to shortly as well. And then, of course, it's about keeping this relevant as well. So moving into the messaging here, we're making sure that every piece of content in the email is accurate and relevant for that individual. So here in this example, we're seeing some of the opening hours for that particular center, making sure they are accurate and up to date, the specific facilities that that center may have, and all the links and phone numbers are correct and connecting you directly to that service center and not some centrally managed call center. So really, these are kind of the basics, but definitely important to get right and are the difference between a high performing campaign and not really. So we'll show in a moment just a few of the more creative ways that we're able to personalize these campaigns above and beyond just the basics. So behind all this stuff is obviously a huge amount of data from a number of different sources. So we have the vehicle data, the customer data, the service center information, just to power the examples I just showed you a second ago. And really, we need a powerful piece of technology that could sit in the middle of all this and bring this all together and bring these campaigns to life. And again, given the name of today's event and Poppy on the call, it's probably no surprise that we're using Salesforce Marketing Cloud to achieve this. So we'll talk, Poppy's going to walk us through in a moment just some of the specific features that can help power this stuff. But yeah, this is really a way that we were able to combine and make sense of the data and deliver these campaigns in a timely and effective way. So I won't go into the specific features now, but I'll throw it back over to Poppy, who's going to walk us through a little demo of some features.
Awesome. Thanks, Mike. So I know we have a bit of a mix of knowledge levels on the call today. So for those of you who are already familiar with Marketing Cloud, this will serve as a nice bit of a refresh for you. And for those who haven't seen it before, this will serve as a good overview of what you can expect to see within the platform if you were to get this moving forward. So coming on into the platform then, let's take a good look. So this is what we see when we enter Salesforce Marketing Cloud. And this is where marketers rally around their single most important asset, which is, of course, the customer. And all the channels of engagement that we have and that we can use as marketers, this is all seen over on the left-hand side of the screen here. And here you can see email, you can see mobile, and there I'm talking about SMS and push as well, so your apps you can connect up. We have social, we have ads, and we have web as well. These are all natively available inside the platform. So these are on the left, but to the right of these, we can then see our builders, and these support our studios. So there are different builders here for reporting and for other areas for automation. But what I want to draw your attention to is Audience Builder that you can see just at the far left, far right even of the builders just there. And really the key message that I want you to take away from Audience Builder is about the data. And really everything that you need to know about the data is that you can bring all of the data in that you want to from all of the different sources that you'll be collecting information about your customers on. So think about e-commerce data, think about loyalty, about stock availability, financial attributes, whatever it might be for that's relevant to your particular customers within your particular industry, you can bring that in to then enhance the experience that you're then giving to your customers. And once that data is brought in, it's all connected to the individual itself that it relates to, and it can then be used throughout the rest of the platform that we can see here, all those channels that we can see to the left, that you can then use to personalize the messages that you're sending from those particular studios that we see. And then we can leverage artificial intelligence as well on top of that through Einstein to help us make more of this data. So let's take a look at these Einstein capabilities that we have here. Now, Einstein refers to all of the artificial intelligence capabilities, both within Marketing Cloud and actually through the rest of the Salesforce ecosystem. It bleeds into all parts of the platform. And here we can see just one element of Einstein that we have available within Marketing Cloud. And here we can use Einstein engagement scoring to automatically build predictive segments. So, for example, the squares that are highlighted just at the top left there, this is enabling marketers to have buckets of customers who are least likely to open the next email that they might be eligible for. And of course, that will go all the way up to most likely to open as well. But what this is doing is automatically placing those customers into those segments for you, and it's using the technology to do that so that as a marketer, you can just use that as you're creating the particular campaigns that you want to be able to create. So here, for this particular segment who are least likely to open, of course, we then can say, well, actually, we're going to use a different channel to communicate to them because this is still an important message. We still want them to receive this content, but clearly email is not the right channel. So we can go ahead and choose a different one in amongst a journey that we're already running and have this automatically figuring out which particular channel a customer should be receiving. So let's take a look at a journey that we could place this into and use this within. So coming on into Journey Builder then, for me, this is really the heart of all engagement within the platform. And journeys are similar to campaigns, but there are a few key differences because within journeys, we're really talking about the entire customer engagement. So it's all encompassing of all business functions, not just marketing. It's encompassing service, it's encompassing sales. So as you can see, we've got an overview here of all the different journeys that we have within this particular instance of Marketing Cloud. And we're currently looking at a retail instance, but of course this will apply to all industries, and there would be different journeys depending upon industry. So as you can see, the second journey down on this view, there is a customer complaints journey here. So this could be triggered off the back of a service case perhaps being closed. We may then want them to come into this journey so that we can send them particular messaging to encourage them to go ahead and say, give us information through a survey of how that particular case went. So we're incorporating our service team within this as well. Coming on to another type of use case that we could use this for, again, including other areas of our business. If you look down to the more central journeys that we have in this view, if you're within financial services or within the automotive industries, the ability to run distributed marketing is also important, and that's supported here. So when I talk about distributed marketing, what I'm talking about is really having a centralized marketing strategy. So the journey here is completely configured by and controlled by the marketers. They're creating the series of messages that the person would receive. Maybe that's all just email messages, maybe across other channels, completely up to you. But within each of those messages, there can be specific blocks within those that marketers can allow the rest of the teams to be able to change if they want to. So think of branches, of brokers. They will have firsthand knowledge of the customers. They may have been speaking to them on the phone or face-to-face when, please, we can get back to that. They would have that first-hand knowledge that they can then further personalize those messages with. And so they can personalize those specific content blocks within those messages, again, to make sure that the customer experience is as defined by the customer as possible. So that's, those are a few examples of types of journeys, but let's take a look at a specific journey now. So now if we consider something that every industry would use, and that's a welcome journey. So Typically for new customers who sign up, we would want to send them an email. And with Journey Builder here, we're able to make simple journeys a lot more sophisticated by using activities such as, and there are many, but one could be random ABC tests. So we could go ahead and test not just different emails, but also different paths that customers could go down, depending upon either the data that sits behind them or the types of engagement levels that they're showing to what we're sending them as well. So we might want to test different combinations, perhaps, of channels. And actually, a lot of customers see that that's very useful for getting to that conversion, whatever that conversion looks like for that particular business, is combining different channels. Now, we can extend that even further and include those AI capabilities that we've already touched on with Einstein activities. So one here that we have up at the top there, that's to predict the optimum time and day to send that particular email. So that's based on previous history that we have about each and every individual within the platform. We're then identifying what the right time and day is to send that particular message, and we're waiting until that time for that particular person. Or we could use Einstein again to identify if email is indeed the right channel for them, as we spoke about a moment ago, or perhaps we want to break them off into receiving that particular message on a different channel. We can go even further if we wish to as well, as we see down at the bottom there, by bringing in external activities. So this could be, for example, informing one of your partners to physically send something by the post. We might not be accessing all of our customers digitally. So here we've seen that we can bring together online channels, we can bring together offline channels, and we can also leverage artificial intelligence within this as well to make sure we're delivering sophisticated and personalized experiences to our customers. But what about the measurements of these types of journeys? Well, we can also measure how these journeys are performing in relation to our business goals. And these goals can be set around that data that we mentioned already that we're bringing into the platform. So any of that we can use to then set our particular goals for the particular journeys that we are creating. So as part of this welcome journey, for example, the call to action for this is to get people to sign up to the rewards program for Northern Trail Outfitters, which is the retail brand that we're using here, just as an example brand. So essentially what you have within a journey is a strategy to then achieve a goal. And that goal is set by you, the strategy is set by you, so that you can then track if you are meeting your business goals. And you can track that as they are running, as they are live, as people are constantly flowing through them, and you can make adaptations and iterations to these as we always need to, as and when you see fit. So let's go into a bit of a different journey now. Now, this journey that I'm wanting to show you here, this is triggered by customer behavior on the website instead. So to help marketers to provide an even better experience for customers, we have our integration with Google Analytics 360. So, and that's 360, the paid for version, just to make that clear there. And what this allows you to do is use all of that rich information that you have about what customers are doing on your site. So what are they looking at? What are they spending their time on? What are they clicking on? What are they searching for when they're trying to navigate your website? All of that is incredibly useful, of course, to be able to identify what your customers want next. And so what we can do is create segments off of all of that information inside of Google Analytics 360, and then pass that into Marketing Cloud and use that here, as we're seeing, as an entry event. And then we can send them all of the messaging that we're used to accessing within Marketing Cloud. So we have access to all of those different channels. And of course, we have access to all of the data that we already hold on that individual inside of Marketing Cloud as well. So if we go through this example that we see here, we are bringing in customers who have viewed a particular product line. So tents is the example that we're using on this one. They have viewed that multiple times within the last, say, 2 weeks, completely up to you. And then we're pushing them into here because they haven't purchased yet, but they are showing a certain level of intent so that we know that there is worthwhile activities to be done here in terms of messaging. What we're then doing is the next activity we've got there, that's going and checking the data that we have inside of Marketing Cloud. So for this example, we're checking lifetime spend of each customer. Those who have a high lifetime spend, we're sending them a particular message because that's relevant to them. And then those who have a low lifetime spend, we want to send a little bit of a different message because we're going to articulate our message here in a different way. Really nice and simple, but if you think in the context of right now, certainly myself and the friends that I've been talking to, the colleagues that I've been talking to, we are all spending an incredible amount of time online because there's not much else to do once you've had your one walk for the day, or maybe two now. But we are spending a lot of time online there, and there is a lot of information to be gleaned from what we as customers want. And so to be able to use that either in real time or whatever timelines you want to then personalize the messages, that's incredibly important for us as businesses to be doing right now. And we can do that with this out of the box integration that we have here with Analytics 360. All right, so that brings us really to the end of what I wanted to show you inside the platform. It's really just a taste that I wanted to give you of Marketing Cloud, but let's just summarize what we've seen before we move into the rest of the pieces. So we've seen how we can unify the profile of each individual, bring all of the data that we want, and then start to use that. We've seen how we can start to create smart segments by leveraging artificial intelligence within the platform. We can then create dynamic interactions, both within our digital marketing channels, but of course, throughout the rest of the business units within our business that a customer will need to touch as they go through their life cycle. And we've also seen some of the insights that we can glean from that as well, and how we can use that to perfect our marketing going forward. So all of this is available within the platform to help marketers to personalize the experience. But in practice, this can actually be taken even a step further within the messages themselves that we're sending within these experiences, so that they have a very detailed level of personalization within them. So I'm going to hand back over to Mike to show how that has been done.
Great. Thank you very much, Poppy. Perfect. So I'm actually now going to hand it straight back over to Bradley Guy, who's on our team, and he's a certified Salesforce Marketing Cloud consultant as well. And he's just going to walk us through some of the more creative ways that we're applying this personalization to the campaigns that we're doing for Toyota. So over to you, Brad.
Thanks, mate. So I'd like to kick off this morning with this number here, and I'm only going to say it once, so don't worry. 148,913,941,562,100. And what this number represents, after some calculations, is the total sum possible combinations of dynamic content variants in each email campaign that we're currently servicing for Toyota. And we're currently sending with Toyota 34 different campaigns. So this number is actually exceptionally higher if you times that amount across the activity that we're currently doing. So as Mike said, over the next 5 minutes and the next few slides, I'm going to break down creatively some of the more personalized ways we're adding hyper-personalization into Toyota's email campaigns. So our ambition with Toyota was always to deliver one-to-one email communications with their customers, because we know that the more personalized the messaging, the tone and the creative, the more positive the reception and the reaction by their customers. The starting point for a lot of the customization in Toyota's emails begins with the imagery of the campaign. So we often begin with the recipient's own Toyota model as the focus point. We begin to take this further by introducing color to the car models inside the campaign. So it's bringing that personalized imagery ever closer to the recipient's own model of Toyota. The further we take this type of personalization, the more we build that relationship between the customer and the specific garage. As Mike mentioned earlier, these emails are centrally managed. So creating that feeling of a garage demonstrating their knowledge about their customers, their cars and their needs, the more we build the trust and the relationship between the two while remaining centrally managed. Another layer of personalization we add is starting to apply seasonal backgrounds to each email campaign. These campaigns are starting to go automatically now. So these are adding a sort of timely nature to these campaigns, and they're grounding them in reality. So it's not just a central process spitting these out, they're coming through in a timely manner, and it looks like that as well. And we begin to see what these come together to look like in the top of a campaign. We begin to see what the finished product of these campaigns look like. So we have a few variations here. We see the dynamic content changing between products and campaigns, as well as some of the imagery as well. How we achieve this level of personalization platform is through using AMP script. Some of you may be familiar, some of you may not. So what AMP script is a code and language which is specific to Salesforce Marketing Cloud. It can be a little bit more complex than drag and drop dynamic content builders that some of you might be more familiar with in other ECRM platforms, but it's a super flexible tool and it allows for really deep and greater levels of complex personalization. And what's great about it is that it can be used in emails, but it can also be used in other areas as well within Salesforce Marketing Cloud. such as SMS, and it also can do back-end processes such as reporting. The next slide here, we can see that these are just some of the data points that we use in Salesforce and in marketing with AmpScript to generate these emails, and how every piece of content that we have in these emails is really supported by a piece of data. So we're trying to get as granular and detailed as possible, serving the most personalized content as possible. So you can see here, we have a mix of Toyota's own data, recipient data, which is stored in their own system, CRM data, and national data as well, things like reference and DVLA data for that MOT information. The next few slides show some variations in the content and different types of campaigns. So we're utilizing quite heavily the template builder and email studio inside Marketing Cloud. This allows us to create a basic framework for all these emails and allows us to quickly create new templates which retain the same dynamic rules. So we're not losing any of that personalization, even though we're serving over 30 different campaigns. The next slide as well. So what you're seeing there, different service type emails, but that's not all that we're servicing with this level of content. We're also doing nurture campaigns, engagement campaigns, which all built upon the same template structure and utilizing the same personalization rules. So just to recap how we reached that number of 148 trillion, if we take all the different car models combined with all the different car colors, as well as all the different product information, which is dynamically displayed across the different email campaigns in your Toyota, as well as times in that by the amount of different service centers we're currently servicing, that's how we reach that magic number of 148 trillion combinations per email campaign. So I'm going to hand back over to Mike now, who's going to wrap up the case study, and I think we're going to head into some questions at the end as well.
Perfect. Thanks, Brad. Yeah, so that's really some of the ways that we've been a bit more creative with some of the personalization elements we've added to these campaigns. And, you know, we are seeing some fantastic feedback from customers and from the service centers themselves here. So we know that, you know, we feel anyway that we're achieving that local personalized approach that we set out to do. And here are just some of the nice bits of feedback that we've had. And feedback's lovely, but it does come down to numbers at the end of the day. So we're seeing some impressive results off the back of this as well. We can see here we're far outperforming those industry averages we saw at the beginning. Remember, the automotive industry was one of the lowest. But really, the true sign of success is above and beyond just opens and clicks. And it's about, for Toyota anyway, the number of additional vehicles that they're seeing back into the network through the use of these campaigns, which has had a huge impact. So we're also starting to think about where we could take things next. What valuable data do we have, and what channels will be most effective to communicate with the car owners with? So as we're now moving towards the era of the connected car, and many manufacturers have actually already started doing a lot of this stuff, there's no reason why we couldn't fire you an email or a push notification or an SMS when your tire pressure is low or your 10,000 mile service is due, or maybe it's a WhatsApp message to remind you that you need to fuel up on the way home. So really those kind of things. So whilst this is very specific to the automotive sector, I imagine many of you on the call are already thinking about what data you've got available and how you could use this to tailor your communications and achieve that level of hyper-personalization. One other thing we're hoping to introduce very soon as well is going above that the model and the color, but actually now starting to overlay your number plate here. So your car reg number into that image, onto that season, leaving absolutely no doubt that this campaign was built just for you, which we think will just be a nice little touch. So to kind of just summarize here what we feel has worked really well for us in Toyota, it's having that, working with that forward-thinking brand who's always open to new ideas and willing to try new things, having that trusted partnership that we've built up over time, combining with the powerful technology such as Salesforce Marketing Cloud, and overlaying our world-class creative has really helped us achieve some fantastic results and has been our recipe for success. And very lastly here, I just wanted to finish off with another quote from Litmus. So brands that have resisted the personalization wave will find that their reliance on one size fits all email might shut them out of the inbox as customers grow more apathetic to their messages. And we're definitely seeing this. So last year, average click-through rates jumped from 0.9 to 2.4%, meaning that more customers really saw more content that was relevant to them and on a deeper level. So it seems that many brands are getting wise to this and they're getting it right, which is a great thing to see. But I'm sure if you look again in your inbox today, you'll probably see some not so great examples. So I guess I would just finish by saying, if you're looking to increase the level of personalization in your messages, or you just want to chat about all things email or Salesforce Marketing Cloud, if there's any way we can help support, please get in touch. But with that, I'll throw it back over to Ollie, who will hopefully read out some questions if we have any.
Yeah. Firstly, I hope everyone agrees. What excellent talks from all the teams. Some really, really interesting stuff and showing what's possible with great technology, very, very smart marketeers, and yeah, just showing what is possible. Also conscious that I foolishly didn't introduce myself. I was consciously thinking of all the speakers and making sure that I mentioned their names, but didn't mention who I am. So I'm Ollie. I'm Jellyfish's new business director. I've been working at Jellyfish for a long, long time, seen huge growth at Jellyfish, but it is always underpinned by the strong relationships that we create with our technology partners. With regards to questions, if anyone has any questions, please do type one into the Q&A box. Maybe just to get things started, I'll ask the team a question. So I'll put a couple of team members on the spot. So no worries, guys. The Toyota case study. Obviously, I'm sure there's lots of people who are listening to this and thinking how that they could actually do that themselves, and what are the different data points that they could be pulling in to make those hyper-personalized campaigns. But as a starting point, Mike, Brad, I mean, how long, roughly speaking, does it take to actually set something up like this? I know that that's a tricky question, but roughly speaking, for Toyota, how long did it take us to get to this sort of level of data and detail?
Sure, I'm glad you asked the question, because last time that question was asked, I got it wrong, and I quoted a far higher number than it actually took. So first thing I would say is, obviously, it has taken time to build to this level, and you don't need to start with this straight away. And going back to the hello first name, like I say, it's a nice place to start. It's a good way of pulling in your data into a campaign and displaying that, and then really thinking about going one step further and using data to display different pieces of content, as we've already covered. But Brad's probably better to answer as to how long it's taken us to get to this point.
I mean, Mike says it's a process to build. So, you know, that we didn't immediately go out the gates with all this personalization and the original campaigns, but by a bit over time, you can build up, write the rules, gather the content, get it together. So I think pre-COVID-19, we were just about to launch a lot of this activity. With the garages shut, but they're starting to reopen, we are going to be launching it. So to build, I think, the current suite of emails, which is around 36 different campaigns, I think the build time was about 2 months, I think, but that was including all the personalization, gathering all the data, working on automations and journey builder, and now we're pretty much at a point in this post-COVID-19 world to launch all that activity.
Thank you, guys. And we've now got a question in from Hannah Payne. With regards to how confident are you in the data that powers the personalization? And have you gone through lots of cleansing to get to this point?
Yeah, so that's a great question. And we're lucky in one sense that we actually, Toyota, have a data partner that reaches out to all the individual service centers and kind of collates and makes sure that the data is accurate. However, if that wasn't the case, well, actually, even when it is the case, we do make sure that there are always fallback rules in place. So I'll use a very basic example, which is if you are doing hello first name, and it's unlikely but not impossible that somebody's first name would be less than, let's say, 2 characters, then you can put rules in place to ensure that you know, you would show a fallback to that. And the same goes if the data isn't in a format in which you expect it to be. Then you can have rules in place that make sure it shows fallback content to ensure, you know, there are no brand consistency issues.
Okay, so we have another question from Andrew Jennings. He's asking, if you wanted to delve into learning AmpScript, which resources would you advise we use as a good starting point?
Okay. I'll kick it off, and then Brad can probably go into a bit more detail here, but If you're familiar with Salesforce at all, then you'll be aware they have a fantastic online learning tool called Trailhead. I'm really giving the Salesforce sales pitch here, so Poppy and Clayton will be happy. But it is an amazing place to start, and they have trails available where you can actually go from from zero to becoming a fully fledged marketing cloud developer or consultant. And that's something you can kind of do in your own time and for free. So that's definitely a great place to start. On the AMP script specifically, Brad?
Yeah, so you'll find some stuff on trailheads and things that are like an introduction, definitely script. And I think recently launched last year, there's a really good new comprehensive guide called AmpScript.guide, which is online. It's written by a Salesforce developer, I believe, Elliot Harper. And it's probably the most in-depth, feature-rich version of learning AmpScript. It goes through all the functions. Most of it is free. I think there is a paid version for like a yearly fee, but it has like the best examples and it shows you step by step pretty much how to format each part of the AMP script. So I'll drop a link in the chat here so you can check that out as well.
We have a question from Kat Edgson. This question is, it's been directed to you, Poppy. So just asking with regards to Salesforce Marketing Cloud, how do you link the ID in GA360 to the individual's email address?
Yeah, so it's a good question because that is exactly what the integration between the two platforms was created to do, because it is a hard thing to be able to link those two separate IDs. So there's a process that all customers need to follow for those IDs to be linked, and the match table is actually built on the Google Analytics side. So what you would do is, with once the integration is complete and it's just a very simple pop in your credentials for Google Analytics, then you can start to create journeys that automatically apply the necessary parameters to the end of the links in any of your emails within that journey. So say it's a three-step welcome journey, a nice one to start off with, because then you can create that link there from the start of that customer being your customer and the start of the engagement with them. Automatically apply the parameters. One of those parameters is passing over the subscriber ID. So that's the back end unique identifier that we use inside of Marketing Cloud. And we use that because, of course, it's not personally identifiable information. So it's completely compliant with Google's rules there of what information you can hold. And then once somebody goes into that email, they click the link, that parameter will of course pass over that ID, and that is stored inside of Google Analytics next to the client ID that Google uses as their identifier on their side. And then you can start to create any segments that you want to, and then once the segments are passed into Marketing Cloud, it just passes back that list of subscriber IDs. So it's the data that Marketing Cloud already owns, so that's compliant again, and then you can use it throughout journeys as we saw before.
Thanks, Poppy. Right, I'm conscious that we're getting close to the looks like we have one more question. Okay, so in the case of an e-commerce landscape, question from Andre Vorster. In case of an e-commerce landscape, if you did not have the data needed for the level of hyper-personalization, would you take any actions on gathering that data from the customers? If so, what would the methods be and the tools you would use?
Great question, Andre. And full transparency, Andre's on our team, so he's put us on the spot here, but thanks for asking. I think it is an interesting point. I know why Andre's asked it, because it is something we're working on at the moment. So obviously collecting preferences is a huge part of a good email marketing strategy as well. So we are, we've been building preference centers out for brands for years. And again, tying it back to Salesforce Marketing Cloud specifically, Marketing Cloud, we didn't really feature any of this today, but Marketing Cloud has its own cloud pages function in there as well. So you can actually build landing pages, forms, websites, all within Marketing Cloud, and be able to capture those preferences, apply them to a contact record, and then use them for future segmentation. So that's the way we would approach that. Great question, Andre.
And with that, just to say once again, thank you very much to the speakers. Great talks by all. And also thank you to all the attendees, because obviously without you guys, we wouldn't be able to have these events. Jellyfish run these pretty regularly. So please sign up to future ones and hear about all the other great information and marketing that we're running and partners that we're working with. With regards to follow up, so there'll be an email sent to everyone tomorrow with my contact details. So if you do have any further questions, require any further information, please do not hesitate to get in contact. Aside from obviously a lot of the stuff that we've been talking today, Jellyfish provides a whole host of Salesforce options. So things like auditing, implementation support, training, and of course, consultancy. So happy to discuss any of those areas more with you guys. And also the talks today have been recorded. This takes a little bit of time to cut up. So they should be sent out to you sort of early next week. So please do keep an eye out for it. Once again, thank you for attending and stay safe.
Thanks a lot.
So, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.